I'm Dolores Gallagher Thompson, for those of you who don't know me, and I'm the director of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. We're delighted to be a co-sponsor for this 16th annual conference. So now let's get to the panel. Our panel will be moderated by Dr. Kala Mehta. It's my great pleasure to introduce her to you. She is an epidemiologist who specializes in aging and dementia. She has won many awards for her teaching and mentorship, and her research has been quoted in the New York Times. And we are absolutely delighted to have her as one of our very valued consultants at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. She also consults for the Stanford Graduate School of Business, and she's on the faculty of at UCSF. And she will introduce the other panel speakers in turn. So, Dr. Mehta.
Thank you, Doris. So, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for being here at this late hour after we've had such wonderful speakers. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the Alzheimer's Association, the local chapter, for their continued commitment to ethnogeriatrics. Every year we come here and we get to hear something about the broad topic of ethnogeriatrics, and for this we are very grateful. This particular panel that we're going to be listening to today is really going to be a treat for you. It is not really hearkening on the basic science, as you saw earlier this morning presented by Gil Rabinovici, Mike Weiner. It is not really about clinical science, which you heard more about by Ron Finley and Dr. Buddha. But it's really about the human aspect, or culture, as it is related to patients with dementia. And I would really beseech each and every one of you to look at this panel in that way. Each and every one of you is coming into contact with patients with dementia or their families. And I'd like you to think about your encounters with them in terms of their cultural context. I hope that this panel for you is an eye-opening experience for the three cultures that will be represented today. Without further ado, I would like to introduce the panelists. The first of whom, to my direct left, is Dr. Melen McBride. She is the Associate Director Emerita and Ethnogeriatric Nurse, a Clinical Nurse Specialist at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. She and I work together. She has over four decades of experience in gerontology, geriatrics, ethnogeriatrics, research and practice, and it would in fact take me possibly four decades to introduce her properly, but I won't do that. So she has a specialization in emergency preparedness, and on the Stanford Geriatric Education Center website, you could find more details about those programs. They're stellar. Another one of her key interests is in Filipino Americans, Asian Americans, Alaskan Natives, and specifically Filipino Americans with relationship to dementia and their and dementia care and the families and how the families are affected. The kind of approach she's used is using cohort analysis, which is a unique approach. So without further ado, I would like to call her to give her presentation. Thank everyone. Let's please give Dr. Melen McBride a big round of applause.
Good afternoon. Magandang hapon. Maraming salamat, Kala, for your introduction. I think you can guess what I said. I am very honored to be here, and it's a great pleasure to join you in the 16th annual Updates of Dementia. I understand that there are many of you who have been constant followers of this conference and that you have been from the day, the first update to today, and congratulations, we ought to really give you a major award and an applause. Can we have an applause for all those who've been here for the last 16 updates? Thank you very much. Okay. And today, this is my learning objectives that I have for you. I'm not going to read it. You have a handout. And by the way, You do have a handout that sometimes you might see that I'm not following your handout, but don't worry, we're going to cover the information that's in your handout. There's also some other handouts that have statistics and a chart that has some cohort analysis. When I get to this, I'm going to go rather quickly on my slides so that then I don't have to repeat myself and also save time. I have 26 slides to show you, okay? So what about the Filipino Americans? What can we say about the Filipino Americans? Basically, really, the Filipino Americans is very much a tribal society. Our origins is in a tribal, an archipelago of 7,200 islands, and only 1,000 of those islands are inhabited. And so you could imagine that we really are Pacific Islander people. Every island has to be kind of self-sustaining and have a certain way of preserving their culture and their identity. And we are also of a history of a mixed genetic and cultural heritage, starting from our original kind of Malayan race, the Muslim, the Chinese, Spanish, and the Euro-Western. And if you see in the map on the slide, there is a huge map on the top, that's Luzon, and then the bottom part is Mindanao. Those are the two biggest islands in the Philippines, and then the rest are smaller islands. And recently, that typhoon Yolanda or Hayun gave you an idea of how much people would have to take care of themselves in weather-related types of disasters. Because of the Spanish colonization, which was present in the Philippines for 477 years, and that is from 1521 to 1897, the Philippines there now is the only country in Asia in which Christianity is the national religion. In your handout also, it will be listed there, the 8 languages that is mutually unintelligible in the Philippines, and the 2 constitutional national language, which is Filipino or Tagalog, and English. And that's a very recent move of the government. And there are many, many ethnic languages. Now, what about the immigration? In your handout, you will have a lot of details on the decades of movement of the Filipinos to the United States and where they were and who were the kinds of Filipinos who immigrated to the United States. But first and foremost, in the 1500s and in the 1700s, there were a small presence of the Filipinos in California, specifically in Morro Bay, and in the Bayou Country in Louisiana. And there are already many generations of Filipinos coming from this progeny of the settlements. Then, after the Spanish-American War, the Philippines was handed over to the United States. It had a Commonwealth government, and for a few decades, the Filipinos had free movement from the Philippines to the United States without any passport, without any visa. People can come in and out, and again, we should think about the kinds of generations that came out of that group of Filipinos. And then the law started coming in, restricting the immigration, many discriminatory laws, and that reduced the number of Filipinos coming to the United States, and the first groups were workers, farm workers, fishermen. And then when the war came, the Filipinos fought side by side with the military, and we had World War II veterans, and war brides came. Then Filipinos also came to study or work. The United States was having a healthcare shortage, and so the Philippines had this first brain drain experience of health professionals coming to the United States, and I'm one of them. I was one of those who came on exchange visitors program. We had followers of adult children, and these were the grandparents coming to help their children raise young families. Now in the current time, we still have professionals coming, students, contract workers, we still have undocumented workers also. And there's one group that you may be seeing also in the healthcare setting, and these are the short stay people. They are coming for health care, and they plan to go back to the Philippines. So if you have somebody receiving that care, part of your care plan would be to say, how do we continue their care back in the Philippines? And Kala had mentioned something about cohort analysis, and you also have a handout there about cohort analysis, and it's very significant and important information for us to find out, not just for the Filipino elders and their family, but for all the other ethnic groups, what historical experiences they have had that might influence their perception of healthcare in the United States, perception of systems and attitudes, and the kind of trust that they might have for the providers and the systems. And this then influences how they behave towards the providers and how they access the system. I also included here a historical trauma because this kind of historical experience is often used by the Alaska Natives and the American Indians to refer to the pain and psychology and the emotional and psychological pain that they had experienced as they were also being more or less mainstream, children being forcibly taken from the family and put in boarding homes and boarding schools. And then it becomes a community pain, a community trauma. So they have ways of dealing with it also. And I mention it here because the Alaska Natives and the American Indians married also many Filipinos. And so you might be running across also families of this kind of mix. And when we are talking about genetic research, then these are the kinds of background information that we may need in order for us to really understand where the genetic lineage is coming from. And the next two slides really are demographics, and you have a handout of that. And this first slide is a way for me to just emphasize the diversity within the Asian American population. It's not just diversity in terms of the proportion of population, it's diversity in the language, their culture, their practices, their belief systems. And so this is really a reminder for us that when we collect data, Asian American is not enough. We have to desegregate those databases and then find out where each one falls so that then it's a little bit easier to target any kind of intervention that we are thinking about and also to find out really what is the cultural beliefs that are happening within those different groups. And the second slide that you also have all this information in a handout is to indicate also the diversity within the Filipino community and again, the diversity within the Asian American community in regards to some of these demographic characteristics. And there's two other things I want to point out in this slide, and that is that it says living alone, 65-year-old Filipino Americans are only 8.8, so there's about 92% of Filipinos, 65 and older, are living with somebody, living with their family, or in some kind of a group household. And so that's a very important thing when you are looking at caregiving plans, working with a family caregiver, and knowing that at the outset, you are going to end up dealing with a group of people, not just one family caregiver, or not just the Filipino elder. The second thing is that there is a very high percentage of college-educated, 57.2%. It's been shown in some research that education is not always predictive of adherence to treatment and management. So let's keep that in mind. I think maybe some of us have experienced that. We were told that we should do something. We just turn around and we say, yeah, no, you know, I'll do what I want to do. And we are all very highly educated. So I think probably this is a fact, and this is something that we just need to remember. And the unfortunate thing that's going on is that there is no epidemiologic data on dementia and caregiving or Alzheimer's in the Filipino population. There are a few spotty reports about dementia, and one can make the conclusion, perhaps, or assumption that because cardiovascular disease and hypertension is very high, is highly prevalent in the Filipino community, that vascular dementia might be one of the top type of dementia that you might encounter. Of course, there's still case finding with regards to Alzheimer's. We still do not know about that. Back in 2010 to 2013, there was a community screening in Los Angeles in Filipino town. And they did a screening for memory changes. And the GPCOG, are you all familiar with GPCOG? An instrument that was used for screening, that there were 92 Filipinos who participated, age 50 to 92. And 21% of them had cognitive impairment based on that mini-cog assessment. And 57% needed more evaluation. And so altogether, that's 78% of the 92 elders. Now, this is not national data. This might not represent the entire country, but it is something for us to think about. And this is only in one city. That's in Los Angeles. We also went out at some point in our work as SGEC to interview some informants about what the Filipino community know about with regards to dementia and the terminologies and all that. And these are really self-explanatory. I'm not going to go into it a lot of detail, except, excuse me, that the one of the interventions that the Filipino caregiver family think about is to bring somebody from the Philippines to take care of a family member who may have dementia, or take the person back to the Philippines. That is still going on. And in 1974, now we'll talk about the Filipino family, because I think really it's really the family that's going to be your client. No matter what you say, you know, it's going to be the Filipino family who's going to be your client. So in 1974, a group in the Philippines, the Media Production Center, announced and acknowledged and gave an award to the Filipino family, saying that they're the most able social system in which respect and love for the parents are taught and are expected of the children. And this still, many of our traditional Filipino-American families in the United States pass this value on to their generations, and think about the generations that may have had this kind of experience, the silent generation, the baby boomers, the Generation X, the millennials, and the Generation X. And in my family, I have an 11-month-old boy who is being taught now how to be respectful to his elders. And what is the cultural definition of the Filipino family? You see here listed, you know, it's very self-explanatory. It goes beyond blood lineage. And the benefactors are people who may be brought in because they are sponsors in weddings or baptisms. And we do have the nuclear family. We do have blended families also, because divorce is also something that happens in our family. And now we have the statistics that says 27% of Filipino-American immigrant grandparents live and care for grandchildren under 18 years of age. Now, this is really a very interesting statistics, because it has some very important effect. One is there's bonding that goes on between the elder and the young one. And then as the grandparent gets frail and then needs help, the bonding between the grandparent and the grandchild can become a positive element, because they become part of the caregiving network of the grandparent. Not necessarily being primary caregivers, but they become part of the caregiving network of the grandparent. And so first is the family. I had an experience where I had a graduate student who was a research assistant and doing Filipino research and she says she has to quit school, and she also has to quit her job, the research assistant position, because there was a family friend who was going to come to their home, and she is going to be responsible for taking care of this family friend who is an elder and who needs care. And so this is how elder care is integrated so much into the family dynamics. Not that it doesn't create tension in the family. There is tension, naturally, for this. But these are some of the realities that we are seeing, continue to see in Filipino families. There was a study on filial piety that was asked, should parents be teaching children about respect for elders and caring for elders? And more than 57-59% of them said yes. Both the native-born young Filipino, the young foreign-born, as well as the older foreign-born, all just mixed, they all said yes, definitely. And these are different titles for respect. And if you are inclined, you are welcome to use some of these titles. When asked permission, can I call you Tita, you know, or can I call you Lola? Sometimes Lola is reserved really for the grandparents, but you can use the title Tita, Tito, or Manong, Manang. And use the word po, you know, in the beginning of my presentation, I said salamat po, you know. And then when you say mano po, that is in the picture. That is what manopo is, that the young person, not just a child, any person younger than the elder can do this as a way of showing respect. And so this slide, I think, is very much self-explanatory. And religion is very much inherent into the system. I have been amazed that actually in the community, at least in the areas in California that I have been, there seems to be a very strong lay ministry among especially the Catholic community and the Filipinos. They have prayer groups and they have certain ministries. They are going into training as lay ministers. And I'm really just amazed that this is even growing stronger than say maybe about 20 or 30 years ago. So I'm not sure whether this is just a trend or whether this is going to continue. There are also healers now that are being discovered, and the University of the Philippines is doing a study of healers who are coming out of the mountains of the Philippines. And they actually were the healers who escaped to the mountains during the colonization period. And they learned about herbs and passed it on to the mountain people. And then now the mountain people are willing to share their knowledge, and the University of the Philippines are working with them in terms of this. It's a similar time a group like the Amazons, like many of our physicians are going to the Amazons to learn from the healers there. So this is going on in the Philippines as a research. And these are caregiving patterns that there are self-explanatory. Basically, these are the choices that families make. And I have 1 minute. Do the assessment. Remember, always, try and make your assessment a family-focused assessment. Find out who is really the decision maker in the family. Create a family tree, because your decision maker may actually be in England, in the Philippines, somewhere in Middle Eastern. You know, the caregiving is becoming global because they are dispersed in different parts of the world. And find out what the caregiver resources are and how did the primary caregiver get into their role? Was it by consensus of the family? Was it by self-assignment? Or was it by default? And we did a brief study on that, and about 50% of the group that we studied were by consensus of the family, and the rest are 25% for each of the category. and this, I think, is explanatory. I can talk about the explanatory model, but I think maybe this is just something that will help you use some questions to perhaps begin trust building. When you see a patient who's new, you're interviewing, you might ask, what do you think may have caused the symptoms or illness? And that might help you get at the belief system of the family caregiver or the family. And this is a communication tool that has been used in the Stanford family medicine program, where residents were given this tool so that then they can begin to build a communication basis and a trust building. And if you have any questions, we can take that up later. It is called the Learn Model. And we use that at SGEC. I think we also have actually a videotape on this. This one is, I think, of all the slides that I have here, this is the one that I enjoyed most putting together, because it's the non-pharmacologic options for behavioral issues when you have a patient who is becoming agitated. And then if you have a good history of the patient, find out what is their favorite snack, what's their favorite music, what's their favorite dance, their favorite games, and what have you, then you might be able to offer something to the family caregiver to say, this could be a reward system. When there is a resistance to taking medication, reward them with a treat that they really like. Let's take this medication, and then you get the fried banana. That's a fried banana right there. And then there's music. Music. We have a student at Stanford, and I'll be done with it. You have a student at Stanford, and she is Filipino, and she has had two grandparents who were Alzheimer's, had Alzheimer's. They're all gone now. But she was very intrigued, because whenever they sing, the agitative behavior disappears. And so she's now videotaping Filipinos with dementia. And we're working together on that. And she showed me one videotape. I tell you, the singing really made a difference. They sang. At first, you could see that it was almost an expressionless face of the elder. And then she started singing with him a lullaby. It's a lullaby that he knew. He had sang to his children and grandchildren. And his face lit up like sunshine. He had smiled and made contact with his daughter. And his daughter said, I have not heard your voice in a year. And so these are some of the ideas. And I can tell you more about the pictures there. Like, for example, that one on the far right that looks like a round thing, those are chocolate balls. And those are indigenous to the Philippines, and it comes from that fruit that's next to it. So the last slide is just for everyone to use this every so often. Ask yourself, in terms of your cultural awareness, what did you learn from the values and assumptions of the Filipino elder and the family? And maybe today, what did you learn today that you might do different tomorrow? Okay, and these last two are resources. I have copies of them at the desk, and if you're interested, then feel free to pick them up. And thank you very much for your patience. And I thank you very much for Kala's generosity for giving me extra seconds.
Yes, let's give Melen a great round of applause. Excellent. Next, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Sang Lee. She is an associate professor in the School of Social Work at San Jose State University. She received her MSW from University of Michigan and a PhD in social welfare from UCLA. She has many accolades and has really devoted her career to Korean Americans on such topics as mental health literacy, dementia, and the experience of dementia family caregivers. She has taught many courses on social work, social welfare practice, and really has covered a lot of ground in increasing people's cultural competence. So without further ado, let's hear more about the Korean community from Dr. Sang Lee.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me well? Hi, I'm Zhang Li. Thank you, Kalar, for a wonderful introduction. And I feel very grateful for to be here today about sharing my own research work with you. So I'm going to talk about Korean-American perspectives about dementia. This is an overview of my presentation. I'll start with some sort of like a background information, demographics of Korean Americans, and prevalence and risk factors of dementia in Korean Americans, and then two main topics, issues about dementia and caregiving in the population, and lastly, tips for providers working with Korean Americans. Demographics. Korean Americans are the fifth largest Asian American subgroups, and they are 9.7% of the Asian population. Their immigration started right after the Korean War, which was in early 1950s. However, the large influx happened during 1980s and 1990s, and you can see the dramatic increase in their numbers in those time period. And afterwards, there has been steady growth, and from 2000 and 2010, there was 32% increase, and according to 2010 census, Korean Americans are now one of the Asian American groups over 1 million in total. Looking at the immigration history, many and actually most of the Korean Americans here today are foreign-born and first-generation, and they live in large metropolitan areas in a few states like California, New Jersey, New York, and Virginia. In terms of the old adults, according to the 2010 census, there are over 140,000 older Korean Americans here, and 20% in poverty, and more than half of them spoke little or no English despite the education level of 45% college plus education. Dementia prevalence and risk factors. I tried to look for information, Korean specific information about dementia risk factors and prevalence. Unfortunately, nothing is available about that as far as I can search. And I couldn't find any Asian specific information either. So that's another area for research about prevalence and risk factors for Asian American subgroup specifics. What I was able to locate is that a national study in Korea, so like Koreans in Korea, so which can give us some insight about what could happen in Koreans in the United States. So the national study was done in 2008, and that year the prevalence rate was 8.4% among elders 65 plus. And for comparison, it's not the same year, but in 2013, the prevalence rate in the United States was 11%. Like here, Alzheimer's disease was the most common type of dementia, and age-specific prevalence rate increases as ages go up to 30% in 85-plus population, quite similar to the case of United States, which is 32% of 85-plus population. From the same study, risk factors very similar to what is found here, like advancing age, being female, lower education, having traumatic head injury, having depression history, and smoking are identified as a risk factor in Korean population, and a moderate amount of drinking and exercise are actually found to be a protective factor of dementia in Korean population. Now moving on to the main topics, issues about dementia, and the information I'm sharing here today is from my own research work, a study about over 200 Korean Americans residing in the LA County, which is the highest concentration area of the Korean American population in the United States, and it is known that 1 in 5 Korean Americans resided in that area. And the study was about public knowledge and perception about dementia, and the work has been published in several articles and presented at some professional conferences, and you can see the full citation information in the bibliography included in your packet. So the first issue, the first point I want to talk about is the stigmatization of dementia insanity. 75% in the study believe that dementia is a form of insanity, and this perception exists in other groups, but it seems to be stronger, and Another study of African American and white adults, they found that only 40% of African American and 10% of white old adults believed so. And one thing I want to mention about this stigmatization is there is an Asian culture norm, so-called face saving, and that considers exposing negative family events as shameful and embarrassing, and they try to avoid public disclosure of those negative events. So if you combine the stigmatization and cultural norm of face saving, that can be a barrier of seeking evaluation and services. The second point is the normalization of memory loss in old age. A significant proportion, 38%, believe that dementia is a normal part of getting older, and majority, 70%, misinterpreted that forgetfulness over age 75 as a precursor of dementia. And whereas only 26% of white old adults considered so in another study. So that means memory problems are expected to occur in old age, and that view is quite prevalent in other Asian groups like Chinese and Vietnamese. So this view may stem from Asian culture norm that old age is period of mental and physical deterioration, and memory problems and related behaviors are expected to occur. So we think that, okay, old age is going back to the childhood, and dependence is totally okay, whatever form it will be. So that can be another barrier for delay seeking services. So many of the initial dementia symptoms can be ignored because they thought that it's just an old age. The next two points are about the causal attribution, what they think bring dementia. So the first thing is about social and cultural attribution. Like, very similar to Chinese and Vietnamese, they believe that troubling life experience, emotional trauma, social relationship problem can bring illnesses, can bring dementia to people. Like, for example, having unresolved personal conflicts, lifetime hardship, issues that cannot be shared with others can bring dementia. And in the parenthesis, I included the Korean culture concept of Han, which I'm going to explain shortly. They also thought that environmental changes like immigration can bring dementia to people. So in Korean culture, tolerating negative experience, whatever that be, like misfortune, miseries, unfair treatment, silently and patiently, is generally considered a virtue. And this Korean culture concept, Han, refers to suppressed emotions, like your anger, frustration, disappointment, and revengefulness, and they are often internalized. So if you carry the Han for a very long time, like for your lifetime, later you are very susceptible to somatic symptoms like huabyeong or mental illnesses like dementia in later life. Another point about the causal attribution is moralizing view. Many believe that you see the percentage is here, not keeping mind active enough, being socially and physically inactive, and having introvert or passive personality can bring dementia. These are good in a way that we can engage people in some sort of like a preventive effort, but at the same time, along with the causal attribution I just mentioned, these attributions can hold persons with dementia accountable. So you brought your illnesses because you didn't your mind active enough, you were inactive, and you had a certain kind of personality. That is something called moralizing view of mental illness in folk psychology. So in moralizing view, abnormality is viewed under the person's intentional internal control, and you brought your mental illnesses. The opposite concept is the medicalizing view of mental illnesses. It's sort of like a biomedical perspective, and abnormality is just somatic deviation. The interesting thing is that dementia here, Korean Americans, they tend to view as a moralizing view, but in some other cultures, dementia is just viewed as a medicalized disorder. So that kind of indicates some sort of like a culture variation of looking at mental illnesses, and we need some sort of like tailored approach depending on which group you're working with. I only have 5 minutes. In terms of their knowledge about the symptoms, they are very well aware of some sort of like symptoms related to impairment in memory and cognition. However, they were not very much aware of more advanced symptoms, like symptoms related mood, personality, and behavior and your psychic changes. Particularly troublesome is, as you can see the data here, not many were aware of symptoms like hoarding, hallucination, fear of baiting, inappropriate sexual behavior, and violent behavior. And this can shed some light on why some Korean Americans, or many Korean Americans, had a stigma of dementia as insanity. Not knowing that these are the actual symptoms of dementia, they misinterpreted elders showing these symptoms, okay, they are crazy. So, and that is also troublesome because these symptoms are shown in generally more advanced stages, meaning they missed opportunity of early intervention. The last thing about the issues about dementia is their knowledge level about the available medication. Not many were aware of some of the availability of medication to potentially delay the progression of dementia and to control the behavior symptoms. Interesting thing was that majority were correctly knew that there's no cure for dementia at present. So if you combine those things, sketch knowledge about dementia and correct knowledge about cure, they may feel or watch or observe some initial symptoms, but they didn't know that there are some available medications and there's a no cure, and why do I need to see a doctor? So that can be another barrier for early detection, diagnosis, and treatment. The next main topic is about the dementia caregiving. So I'll just skip this part and then moving on to the main part. So the thing, the information I'm going to share with you is from one of my own work. I did four focus group interviews with 23 older Korean caregivers with dementia symptoms. Those are living in the Washington, D.C. and Virginia area. And this is from that data, and it was just accepted for publication. So the thing you will see here is sort of like a major themes resonate from their focus group account, and the phrases and sentences you see in the bubble is their actual account, like a direct quote. Obviously, they said they are very struggling and overwhelmed, and they said exhausted, feel like I'm stuck, this is not doable, and they expressed the most difficulty in dealing with the severe memory loss and common behavior symptoms, which I just mentioned that many general Korean Americans were not aware that those are the symptoms of dementia. The next thing is keeping the culture role and responsibility. They mentioned a lot about filial responsibility. They are just doing it because it's my parents. And they are very reluctant to place their family members in a nursing home. They only are thinking about it as their last resort. Only they have to do it, no matter how difficult, how challenging, and how struggling they are. And there are actual quote about how one caregiver, kind of describing an incident of how one caregiver and their family finally made a decision to send her mother to nursing home. So for the sake of the time, I'll can I read it? Yeah, okay, it's okay. Then one day my mother left home and we couldn't find her. We reported her missing to the police and they were finally able to find her. At the time, they handcuffed her and took her to the hospital. She placed in the mental health unit there because she acted out so much they confined her. That experience made us really sad and really hurt us. From there, my mom was sent to a nursing home. We really cried out that we didn't want to send her to a nursing home, but everyone said it was okay. So that was the account. Many caregivers, their caregiving journey was a lonely endeavor, and they received little support from other family members, particularly among the spousal caregivers. They are reluctant to ask for help to their adult children. They said, I just think it as of my own responsibility, and I do not want to bother others. And the other two accounts, the direct quotes, are describing that they do not want to bother their adult children because parents are supposed to do some sort of like happiness for children rather than bothering it. So That's the thing. And the next one is family as a source of stress, particularly for adult children. They expressed a disagreement, dissatisfaction, and stress because of lack of or unwanted advice from other family members. And they describe sort of like a strained relationship with the siblings and in-laws due to caregiving responsibility. So here's a quote, like, to be really honest, they come to our house to check once in a while, whenever it's convenient for them at their time schedule without notice. They say whatever they want and it upsets me. So I really, really don't like it at all. Don't bother coming at all. I don't know how long I can take care of her. This is the case of taking care of her mother-in-law. But as long as I can, I will do it. So I do not receive any help from other family members. The next thing is limited knowledge and misconception about dementia. So like in the case of general Korean Americans, they do not know much about dementia, and they are just learning it as they go. And the big quote you can see here, it basically describes that even though she notices something, she later realized that that's the initial signs of dementia. So she forgot how to cook, but at that time, like, what's wrong? Maybe she's getting old. And later time, her mother didn't recognize banana. And she the daughter kept thinking, what's going on? And she never suspicious about having a dementia. And their knowledge, even for the caregivers, their knowledge was very limited to the symptoms they have observed. So no one was really able to talk about what would come next and what would happen to the family members. So that's another point of the caregiving education for this population. The next thing is a fear of seeking formal diagnosis. All of the caregivers had been taking their care recipient to Korean American physicians regularly, but only 7 of them reported having some sort of memory test, but none had received a full clinical assessment. And caregivers didn't seem to find it important to getting even the full official diagnosis. And one caregiver said, to be honest, maybe we want to avoid it. Honestly, family members may want to avoid it. Family members want to avoid it. Adult children think their parents might have developed dementia. They may be afraid of confronting it, so saying wait and see, I think. And the last point about caregiving experience is various youth services and need of culturally responsive services. All of the caregivers had experience of using some sort of like a formal services like home health care, nursing home, adult daycare center, and rest of care. But all of them equivocally mentioned about services delivered by Korean American providers. And that is really critical, like a facilitator or barrier to continue to use services or look for services. And the quote says, because they don't speak English, they know that the services are out there. They are afraid of coming out and go to the services, or they are just there. And then the other quote saying that there was a one dementia senior patient who spoke little English, and even when she said cold in their own language, in her own language, no one listened to her. And and family members worried that if they send their parents to nursing home in non-Korean setting, their parents do not speak English, and they don't think they can leave their eating American food. That's what they are worried about. So tips for providers working with the Korean Americans, call for education for Korean American general public as well as caregivers. I know that there are great resources about the information for caregivers and general public out there, but certainly the points I mentioned can be integrated to be more specific and geared more specific for Korean Americans. So we need to address specific areas of lack of knowledge and cultural beliefs about dementia. And like I mentioned, we need to increase awareness about various symptoms across the disease stages. And warning signs and initial symptoms are very well publicized. But I mentioned, not many Korean Americans know that dementia is just more than memory problems. And emphasizing those later symptoms, I think, can bring some urgency to people to get diagnosis and memory tested. Because if it's just a memory, people may, okay, I'll just wait and see. But if it can bring more serious, like a behavior problems, people will consider it more seriously. And emphasizing that dementia as a disease, not a stigmatized mental health problem. Sort of kind of related point, develop a tailored approach when dealing with the diverse client population. Certainly there are commonalities, but also differences. Like I briefly mentioned, when we talk about causal attributions of dementia, there are commonalities across different Asian groups like Chinese, Vietnamese, and Koreans, but there are certainly differences. In supernatural and evil spirit kind of things, and ancestor spirit, that those are things identified as a cultural attribution in Chinese population, but hardly that was not found in Korean American population. So we definitely need a tailored approach depending on which group you're working with. Need to think about how to address fear of seeking formal diagnosis. So we really need to emphasize that even if the disease cannot be cured, available medication along with timely diagnosis and early detection can really enhance the well-being of both care recipient and caregivers and the family members as well. The second point is understanding the multifaceted nature of Korean American family dynamics. Family responsibility plays as the basis of caregiving and at the same time source of family conflict. And like in other immigrant families, we need to understand the context of the immigrant family. They are facing double challenges. They're living immigrant life. At the same time, they are trying to preserve their traditional norm of elder care. And obviously, there can be some changes and conflicts in selecting between two different value systems among the family members, and that can create tension and conflict. Like, for example, coexistence of filial responsibility and filial autonomy, the latter is more of the American concept. And if, And the last thing is educational effort and supportive services should address language and culture. And I'm sure that you all know this, and that is also, but that is confirmed again from the caregivers in my study. They are willing to use services, but they expressed a strong preference for services delivered by Korean American providers. And we all know that there is a serious shortage of culturally competent healthcare providers for ethnic minorities, especially those who are linguistically isolated and with limited English proficiencies. And given the current financial climate of the public sector, it would be wise to reach out the existing Korean American providers and collaboratively working with them to address the needs and issues of Korean American caregivers. Thank you.
Let's give a big round of applause to Dr. Sang Lee for introducing us to the Korean American population. Next, I have the great pleasure of introducing Dr. Sadhna Diwan. Dr. Diwan is a professor of the School of Social Work at San Jose State University and is the director of the Center for Healthy Aging in Multicultural Populations, also known as CHAMP. She received her master's in social administration and PhD in social welfare from Case Western Reserve University. And she completed a postdoc at the NIA, or the National Institute on Aging. Her research focuses on the use of home and community-based services and case management. She's been really integrally involved in a community ambassador program in the East Bay and also in Santa Clara County. Her research has been funded very widely by the NIA, the Hartford Foundation, the California Endowment, and the CDC. And she serves on two advisory boards, SourceWise and also the SVCN, the Silicon Valley Council of Nonprofits. Without further ado, she will introduce us to the South Asian American community. Thank you.
Okay, since I chose to be the last speaker of the day, partially because I have a video that I think I would like you to see some of it. It's a 14-minute video, which means I would have to speak for 4 minutes, which is not possible. No. So I will we will watch just a part of it, but the URL where it's available will be on my slides. It's not on your handout. And you can certainly see the rest of it on your own. Okay, but I still need to speak fast. She's saying don't not so fast. I'm going to follow a pretty similar format to what Melen and Tseng presented, but my job is made a little bit easier because you will see there's a lot of similarity between the Asian groups, and of course, given that it's the human condition, there are similarities across all groups. So I'll try and focus on some of the differences and understand that everything that was said about cultural competence, working with families, really applies across the board to all of these groups. So what do we know about research on, and we say Asian Indians or South Asians, but the reality is South Asia, while it has lots of countries, India is the most dominant, largest gorilla in that bunch. So the most of the research that's done is on Asian Indians, and South Asians include Pakistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, etc. The Asian Indian-born immigrant population in the U.S. is the third largest immigrant group in the U.S. after Mexicans and Filipinos. And from 2000 to 2010, the Asian Indian population increased by 68% to over 500,000, making it the largest Asian Indian community in the U.S. But most of you know that the population here is probably much younger because of the tech boom and the workers coming here. But with them are also now coming, you see two subgroups within the Asian Indian community. The early immigrants who came here are now aging. The large numbers came in the 60s and 70s. And then there are the late life immigrants. These are people who immigrate later in life, primarily to join their adult children and be reunified with their families. Similarities and differences exist between these groups on the dimensions of acculturation, English language proficiency, peer and social group membership, mobility in terms of access to transportation, and of course access to services, with late life immigrants facing some greater disadvantages as they have more challenges navigating a new country. Now, research on dementia among South Asians is minuscule at this point. It's in its infancy, which is why my job was somewhat easy because I have less to present, but harder because I had a lot to search. Much of the work that I'm going to talk about today, none of it is mine, is on studies done in the UK, Canada, and India. There, I could not find any studies of dementia and caregiving that are done in the U.S. So there's a huge growing opportunity there for this kind of work. So what do we know about dementia in Asian Indians? The studies are based on prevalence of dementia in India. The population is exploding, as you know, and so will the rates of dementia and cognitive impairment, just because of the sheer numbers of people. The prevalence rates have been found to vary depending on where the study was done. So there are rural prevalence rates and urban prevalence rates, and those vary considerably from 1.4% among those 65 years and older to 3.5% among 60, but as high as 10.6% in rural areas. In urban settings, the prevalence has ranged from 2.4% among 65 plus to 7.5% among 65 and over. And the variability in these rates has been attributed to a number of things. One is to measurement methods. Studies don't always use consistently the same tools when they're doing these studies. Also, the definitions may be variable, or they may actually reflect true diversity. If you consider India, the whole of Europe being one country, that's what India looks like. Every state has its own language, it has its own food, its own customs. So my husband and I don't even speak the same language. We talk to each other in English because we come from different states. So this is sort of it could be reflective of the diversity that actually exists in India. And needless to say, there's no prevalence data on Asian Indian immigrants in the U.S. I have not yet come across a study that actually assesses rates of dementia. The studies have tried to look at the types of dementia, and just as Melen talked about vascular dementia and Alzheimer's disease, what you're finding is, at least in the Indian studies, there's a higher prevalence rate of vascular dementia, and typically this is caused by cardiovascular illness, diabetes, and other physical conditions, and the rate for Alzheimer's is not as high, and the study where it is high, most of the patients were referred from memory clinics. So sometimes, depending on where they come from, reflects the kind of data that's available. What are the risk and protective factors that have been found in these studies? Again, there are studies from different parts of the country, but there are similarities in terms of advancing age, poor literacy level, low socioeconomic status, and positive family history. Positive family history seems to be found in almost all of these studies. Marriage was found to be protective. I guess, you know, that can work both ways. You can have a great relationship and you're happy and you talk to each other, or you complain and bitch and moan and your mind is still working. So, right? So either way, I guess marriage is good. In southern India, what they found was documented family history as a risk factor, and smoking and hypertension. Other risk factors include also smoking, but both inhalant as well as chewing tobacco. And pan and tobacco chewing is a very unique thing in India that you may or may not find in other countries, but that's also worth noting. A protective factor that animal studies have found is the use of curcumin or turmeric. In America, you call it turmeric, but it's the same thing. It's the yellow spice that stains your fingers and your clothes, and it's almost universally found in curry powder that you might know that as. So if we talk about putting turmeric on the chocolate that Melen talked about, maybe we'll be in good shape. All right. So what do we know about patient and caregiver issues? This was a study that was done in Canada, and they looked at how is dementia initially perceived, and when and how do caregivers actually seek help. What they found is that there's a lack of awareness of dementia in general in the population. Common to what you heard, normalizing memory loss is typical as a part of aging. But what that means is there's a delayed assessment and diagnosis for up to 4 years from the time they recognize symptoms to the actual getting of the diagnosis. That's a fairly long time, although the jury is still out as to whether something could have been done to stall this later on. Typically, the primary care doctor is the main referral source to other resources. So they're not going to specialists for their issues, they're going to the primary care doctor, who finally recognizes these symptoms and makes the referral. What happens when there is actually a diagnosis done? So how do caregivers make sense of the experience and the diagnosis of the dementia? What do they think about this? Even after diagnosis, there's a lack of understanding or knowledge of the meaning of dementia. So you could use the word, they may have the diagnosis, but they still don't really know what it means, what it entails. What are all the symptoms, what are the causes, what resources are available, and you heard this also in Dr. Lee's presentation, so some of the themes are pretty similar. But the attributions as to why, what causes dementia vary. The typical one is normal aging, and that goes on as long as there's just memory loss. Once there's other changes, it's harder to keep up that idea that this is normal aging. But there are many ideas of blame, and Indians are good at this. One is that it's your fault. You did something, or if you just didn't try hard enough, if you just put your mind to it and write down, make a diary, you will remember all this. So there is, and part of that may be the immigrant personality. You know, you try and you come here and it's your education. So if you face obstacles, you just try harder to overcome them. And that can work up to a point, but oftentimes when you see that this blaming is evident, it actually has a large impact on the caring relationship because it sets up a great deal of tension between the caregiver and the care recipient. Here's a few others that I thought were kind of interesting. Superstition, that someone has cast an evil eye. And or in Turkey, this the blue symbol is the evil eye symbol that you see in the Middle East, and it's called nazar. And in North India, the term is buri nazar, which means bad, a bad eye. And in South India, it's called drishti, which means someone's again caught, you know, cast an eye on you. And there are techniques to remove the evil eye. People in the North, people can wear these amulets or have a slogan or a tattoo. In the South, they may use salt or chili powder, and they twirl it over the person's head, and then they either throw it back or burn it. But the idea is that we do these things in order to remove the evil eye. And I'm kind of amazed that educated people can have a very rational view of the world and still sometimes subscribe to superstitious behavior, which, right? So here we go, another one, astrology and the planetary positions. It sounds very 60s. The role of Saturn and what that does and where Saturn is in the house. In India, it's called Shani. And Shani is considered to bring bad luck. And there's a seven-year period of bad luck depending on how Saturn is. And I don't understand this very much, so I'm just reporting it to you. But it's, you know, again, people do believe this, and sometimes you have to go with the learned model, as Melen talked about. You may have to ask people, what is it that you would do to help get rid of an evil eye or to work with these issues? Because if that's what you believe, you need to enter that caregiver's reality. My favorite. Symptoms were due to an individual's actions in the past, either in this life or previous life, the notion of karma, which you've all heard of. And here's a great picture of what I call instant karma. It's not even this life or next life, it's right now. So again, here's an idea of blame, right? It's something that you did that made this happen to you. Google is so wonderful when you're trying to look for pictures. What are some tips for service providers based on everything you've heard both from Melen and from Sang, as well as this, you know, talking about Asian Indians? The concept of filial piety exists in almost all Asian cultures, but because of this, caregivers may opt for home-based care rather than residential care options. So for them, a nursing home might be unthinkable, even when things get really bad. So you might want to be careful in how you approach this issue with a care provider. Understanding the perceived acculturation status of the patient. Again, we talked about the two different kinds of people who've, you know, the late life versus the early immigrants. But even among the early immigrants, I have noticed that just because you've adapted to the mainstream, you dress differently, you eat differently, there are a lot of cultural things that you still hang on to. So depending on how acculturated the patient and the caregiver is, they may not consider mainstream programs like daycare or even going to the senior center or an early cognitive impairment group as suitable options because there's not enough people like themselves in those groups. Respect for elders, very common in Asian groups, but it can be a real barrier to open communication and possible solutions. I can't say this to my parents. I can't talk to them this way. That would be rude. And so this, you know, it's taken to its extreme form. It can be very oppressive for the caregiver. This was one thing I found interesting in a study of providers in England. They asked, well, what do you think we should call dementia? What should we call this? How do people understand it better? And one of the comments was, well, the word dementia may actually be preferred to other terms because dementia is outside the cultural context. In South Asian languages, if you try to find a translation, you might end up suggesting madness or stupidity, which is even worse. And so if people don't speak English, they're not linking dementia to anything sinister. It may well be some strange disease. I thought it's better than the stigmatizing the condition. So that's an interesting idea. The service provider tips, again, are pretty similar. Psychoeducation, reframing caregiver options with and responses within the cultural context. And you may have heard this, like asking a caregiver to take care of themselves in an Asian family may not get a lot of traction, but taking care, taking time off and doing things so that you become a better caregiver may actually get them to do things that are good for them. Communication strategies for both the patient and the family, coaching, role-playing are going to be helpful. Understanding the cultural terms. In India, we always use a form of respect for actually not just all elders, for sure, is the term ji. We always say like kala ji or saying ji. And it's just a respectful term. We almost always use it without even thinking about it. You typically want to do that with an elder or at least ask the family member, how would you like to be called? And I found this to be interesting, the use of available ethnic resources, support groups, web-based resources, consultation with ethnic providers. And I did not realize that there are these amazing resources out there, which I am going to show you a little bit of this interview, because what I'd like you to see is how much of what we talk about is what this caregiver experienced. So we won't see all of it, but just a little.
So I'm Swapna Kishore, and the patient I look after is my mother, and she's got dementia. I think it's been around 7 or 8 years since she was formally diagnosed. Though she had been to some specialists before, they didn't give me the word. They just said, yeah, this is, you know, it won't get better and all that, but they didn't give me a formal diagnosis. Then around 8 years back, a doctor said, okay, you've not got a formal diagnosis, and he gave me a formal diagnosis. See, the word dementia in English is often misused in the sense, of course, I had heard the word, but I had not heard of it as a, you know, medical word as such. You, when someone acts vague, you know, people joke and say, oh, he's got dementia, oh, he's demented, this behavior is demented. So the word has sort of got desensitized. So although I'd heard the word, I had not heard of it in a medical context as a disease which is physically caused, but as a sort of a behavioral thing which explains odd behavior. My mother's symptoms were not of the sort where we took her for the symptoms like memory loss. Her problem was really balancing. She was having a lot of problem balancing. In retrospect, I can say that yes, she did have other symptoms also, and she was covering them up very well, which also I understand now is a common theme. She was covering up her inability to recognize people by saying, of course I recognize you, when she did not. By using various, and she was keeping herself apparent in social ways as being active, whereas she was suffering loss. She'd stop reading books and say, oh, they don't interest me. In retrospect, I can see that she knew they were, she was not able to understand them. See, the whole thing is that in the diagnosis, they say dementia, they say it's memory loss, they say it's incurable, but they don't really prepare you for what memory loss means in the context of dementia. So to us, normally, memory loss is misplacing a key. It's, you know, forgetting the name of someone in front of you. It's not like you forget who you yourself are. It's not like, as I can see in my mother's case, she would forget where the toilet is. Or she would forget, even if taken to the toilet, she forgets what it is used for. When people talk of memory loss, again, the word is a devalued one. You forget your key, people say, oh, senior moment. You know, people joke about it. So when the doctor says, oh, she'll have more and more memory loss, the impact of it, of what it means in real life, did not strike. So, I was not prepared for it. Although I knew it was memory loss, although I knew in theory it'll get worse, I didn't know what memory loss meant. I mean, what does a person do who doesn't remember who she is? How will she react to someone else leaning over her or telling her to do something? She can't remember a word, how would she react? What memory loss means in real terms, and not memory loss as of losing a key, but memory loss as of dementia. Yes, it hit me hard. She used to be repeating questions again and again. I would lose my patience. I would feel helpless. She would accuse me or the maids of stealing things, of wanting her house. It would. She was getting suspicious. She was getting repetitive. She was getting very difficult to handle. I had no idea how to do it because nothing prepared me for it. I just expected memory loss. It was difficult because in the beginning, for example, in the first few years, I used to be working. I used to sometimes work from home, and sometimes I would cook the food, leave it for her, and go off. And she would come back and say, you've not kept food for me. And once she went to a neighbor and told them my daughter's not giving me food because she's too busy, so she hired the neighbor to cook and give food, and the entire neighborhood knew. You know, her daughter is not giving her food. And I told her, look, the food was right here. She says, nobody came and gave it to me. I said, if I'm not at home, you just have to, it's all in casseroles. And it became very difficult socially. I had to change my pattern of working. I had to switch over totally to working from home. And I was in a profession where that's not always feasible because you do need to meet people if you're a consultant or you're developing systems for them. So there were a lot of things, and it kept, you know, I did not know about support groups. I surfed a bit on the internet. Of course, they all said memory loss. I didn't think about what it meant. I think one of the problems as I think about now is that a lot of people, as I myself did not know, although I had a patient at home, a lot of people do not understand what dementia means. Even if you tell them, they either don't understand or they don't believe. So if a person says that, you know, my mother has dementia, say, yeah, we all know about old age. We all have it. And especially old persons, you know, they say, oh, we are also old, we also forget. And a lot of old people, you know, they want active lives, they want to meet people and all that. And a dementia patient's need is to have routine. So there's a limit to how much, for them, everything is new. You see, a person who's forgetting everything, they're sort of losing their navigation of the world all the time. So for them, even ordinary activity is a new and strenuous activity. There's a limit to how much new stuff you can do with a dementia patient without taxing them. So it is considerate to follow their routine. But the old people around us, they think that a person imposing a routine is being cruel. Because they can't imagine living an old life like themselves. You know, they can't imagine a life in which they would be following the same routine day after day. So a lot of old people around me, friends, colleagues of my father, friends of my mother, there are some relatives, they were very suspicious about what I was doing. They thought I was either being lazy or inconsiderate. If I told them dementia, they would just dismiss it and say, oh, we all know about old age. It's just a faster old age, that's what they called it. So I faced a lot of criticism from people. There was an old lady who would even, you know, she would come and tell my mother, you don't have willpower. Why can't you read? You say you have done MA. My mother's a triple MA. And she would look at my mother and say, why can't you read this? You say you have done MA, now you can't even read this. And I would say, please don't say that to her, it hurts her. I'm only encouraging. In front of the lady, she would say, yeah, I will read. Then that lady used to say, don't let your daughter stop you. And she said, my daughter stops me. She would put the blame on me. And after the lady would go, she would cry. She would just cry and say, what can I do? I can't read. But on other days, she would say, you are stopping me from reading. You are the reason I can't read.
Basically, what she says is she didn't understand what dementia meant even after the doctor told her it was dementia. She says, I didn't know the word. I didn't understand what it meant. And then her mother starts to deteriorate over time, and she talks about how friendly neighbors, kindly visitors come over and want to spend time with the mother and again say, well, you should do this, you should do that. If you only did this, you would be better. And next time I come, I want you to have done this, this, and this, otherwise I'm not coming to visit you. Yeah, really. But if you think about it, I've heard this stuff before. It's well-meaning. It's not intended to be cruel. It's intended to be helpful, to be supportive, to be challenging the person to do better. But obviously a person with dementia is unable to process all that and internalizes it as it is their own fault. And what she talks about is how her mother got even more agitated when people would leave. And so finally what she did was start to slow down the number of visitors who came to the house, which is the complete opposite of what we might expect. But for her, this was really a way to cope because she didn't need that social pressure in terms of, A, the mom was not doing what she needed to do, and the caregiver then, by definition, was not being an adequate caregiver. So I'm going to stop there because we should have a few minutes for questions.
Excellent. Thank you. Big round of applause for Dr. Diwan. And so now, next, what I'd like to encourage is a rich discussion introducing these three communities. Now, understand that this is a small disclaimer before we get started. Obviously, there is a large amount of heterogeneity within the Filipino community, within the Korean community, within the South Asian or Asian Indian community. So this is just an introduction and just some beginning ideas. And we're going to go around and elicit questions from the audience. So please, if you have them, we'll bring microphones around to you.
Thank you. Is it on? I'd like to know who the spokespersons are in each of the ethnicities, please. The family spokesperson.
Well, I think it's probably the primary caregiver, and it's typically even though culturally it should be the sons, I think it's the daughters-in-law, but that son is always there, so that there would always be consultation between the daughter and the brother, or the daughter-in-law and the son. So there is that dual thing going on.
I would say the case is quite similar in Korean American context, and primary caregiver, which used to be the female in the family, either daughter or daughter-in-law, they are responsible for more of the hands-on caregiving tasks. But when there needs to be a decision making, particularly including some sort of like a financial decision, I do say definitely a sort of like a male figure, son or husband, kind of like a joint discussion.
For the Filipino elder, I think first establish really who is that person who is providing care, because that person might actually be a relation from the Philippines who was brought here to take care of that older person. And so that person may not really have all the information. And if there is a daughter who is the primary caregiver, or a grandson, then I think there may be certain kinds of decisions that they can make. And if you notice a certain kind of hesitancy in terms of the question that you're asking, then you might want to ask a little bit, do a follow-up question as to whether is this question to be also answered by some other members of the family, you know, and then you could say, okay, if you could, maybe either I can call them, or if they could provide you with the answer and the next time I see you, then we can talk about it. Because that's just the nature sometimes of the sharing of caregiving in the Filipino family.
Excellent. Next question.
Provide support with things like dressing and bathing and maintenance of activities of daily living. Is that getting to be more accepted in the three cultural communities that you represent, or is that still as stigmatized as nursing home placement?
Part of the study I shared with you about the caregivers, we also did interviews with the personal care assistants, PCAs, who are coming to the patient home and assist their daily living. The thing is, they are not, so their client just happened to be the dementia patient, and they are not particularly trained for dementia. So they also express that this is the most difficult job, and they can't do that for that long. And they're learning about the illness as they're actually doing the job. But when they are taking care of a Korean patient, they are doing more of it out of affection for sharing the same heritage. And some of the things I shared about the family conflicts and all those kind of things, they actually watched those kind of things while they are doing on the job. So I think they are doing it, and they are accepting those kind of help, because once you are in the caregiving, caregivers know that this is not just one person's job and you can't just do it by yourself. So it's, but I'm not sure about the availability of the Korean American PCAs. I'm not sure, but if they're available, they are willing to do it. And some of the caregivers, they had experience of not using non-Korean PCAs and their experience wasn't that good.
Sure. I think that as far as home health goes, when the home health visit is explained and well understood, that very often that is well received. And one thing is hospitality is also very strong in the family household. And so first and foremost, when you are a home health visitor, you are a visitor, you are a guest. And so you really do not come with authority, you are a guest. And so when you start interviewing and asking questions, that the questions need to be phrased in a way that you're really there looking for information so you can help. Sometimes when we are in a hurry, when we're trying to do our job, we have another family to visit, then we might become a little bit more abrupt in how we ask the question, or if the person is getting a little bit slow in answering the question, that you might try and hurry up and then repeat the question, you know. So those are some of the sensitivities sometimes that happens, and you may be welcome at that time, and the next time perhaps they might give you another reason for not being in the home at the time when you want to be there. And but there are some families who would welcome because they may have requested that. If they had seen a social worker in the clinic or in the hospital and they say, I really need help at home, then you would be naturally expected and you would be welcome. They may also offer you a drink or a snack. So, depending on how you feel about having something in somebody else's home, that's your professional decision.
Thank you again. One more last final round of applause for our panel. It was wonderful. Thank you all for coming. Again, fill out those forms and we'll see you next year.